Harper Children's Audio presents Nightmare Academy by Dean Lorey, performed by Oliver Wyman. Copyright 2007 by Dean Lorey. Production copyright 2007 by HarperCollins Publishers. Part 1. The Nightmare Division. Chapter 1. Monster in the Model 3. On most days, Charlie Benjamin was pretty sure he was the loneliest kid on planet Earth. He went to school by himself in his home on a quiet street inside a gated community. Although the houses all looked nearly alike on the outside, there were several different models a buyer could choose from. The Benjamins lived in a Model 3. "The Model 3 is the superior model," Charlie's father frequently told him. He was an exact man with the exacting name of Barrington. "The ones are obviously prototypes. Less said about the ones, the better. The twos, however, are what happens when you rework something too quickly. You often take two steps backward to take one step forward." Which brings us to the threes. The simple, solid, dependable threes. The Model 3 was Charlie Benjamin's prison. At 13, he was short for his age, with unruly, sandy-colored hair, dark brown eyes, and a spray of freckles across his nose and cheeks. His elbows and knees were remarkably unscabbed, and he had virtually no bruises, thanks to his well-meaning mother's insistence that he stay inside the house. "It's an uncertain world," she often told him. "I can protect you in here, but once you step outside..." This was always followed by a grave shake of the head, as if the horrors of life outside of the Model 3 were too painful to contemplate. "I know you keep saying that," Charlie said to her one Saturday morning after a particularly grave shake of the head. "But that doesn't make it true. I'm tired of being stuck here all the time. I want to go to regular school." "Regular school?" his mother replied. "Honey, we have everything a regular school has right here. Books and computers, papers and pencils, tests and grades." "But no students," Charlie interrupted. "I mean, other than me." "That's true," his mother agreed pleasantly. She was such a pleasant woman, in fact, that she'd never even blamed her own mother for naming her Olga. "And thank goodness, because no students means no teasing, no bullying, no making fun of you just because you're a little bit different." Even though Charlie was the first to admit that he was more than a little bit different, protecting him from the abuse of other kids by locking him away in the house seemed a little to him like removing a splinter in his finger by chopping off his hand. It got the job done, but at what cost? "The price is just too high," he thought as he heard the mailman shove the morning mail through a chute in the front door. With a sigh, he walked over to retrieve the usual assortment of bills and catalogs, always for his parents, never for him. And that was when, to his astonishment, he spotted a small blue envelope addressed to Charlie Benjamin.
"That's me," he gasped.
Almost in a daze, Charlie opened the envelope to reveal an invitation to a party. And not just any party. It was a sleepover party at the home of some kids who lived just down the street. Charlie didn't know them personally, of course. He didn't know any kids his own age. But clearly, someone there had taken pity on the small, strange boy who lived in the Model 3. Charlie read the invitation twice to make sure it really said what he thought it said. Then he read it once more for good measure. Once he was satisfied that he wasn't dreaming the whole thing, he showed it to his parents.
"Absolutely not," his father said after glancing at the invitation.
"But why?" Charlie shot back. "I've been good. I've done all my schoolwork. In fact, I just finished the chapter on geography." Honey, what your father means, his mother said, is that we certainly wish you could go, but what if you have one of your nightmares?
One of his nightmares. Even though it had been years since Charlie had had a catastrophic nightmare in public, the thought of it happening again made him absolutely weak with dread. And yet, here was an actual, real opportunity to make a friend. He couldn't pass it up. So he begged his parents. He pleaded. He offered to do the dishes for a year and mow the lawn and learn French. He argued that it had been so long since his last unspeakable nightmare that he had surely outgrown them. Finally, he told his parents that going to the sleepover party was the only present he wanted for Christmas and his birthday combined for the next 2 years. Three, if that's what it took. After much arguing behind closed doors, his parents finally relented. Which is how, later that night, Charlie found himself skipping up the steps of a stranger's house with an overnight bag slung over his shoulder. "You know how to get a hold of us if utter disaster occurs?" Charlie's mother asked nervously, following behind him.
"Yes, Mom, I know how to use a phone."
"Do you want me to quickly review any of the foos I've taught you, Kung or otherwise?" his father offered.
"I'm not going to need to fight anyone with kung fu, Dad. Nothing's going to happen, trust me."
"We never should have permitted this," his mother moaned. "And a sleepover, no less. What were we thinking?"
"Nothing will go wrong,"
Charlie said, looking longingly at the other boys inside the house. They were clearly already having a blast.
"I won't have any nightmares tonight, trust me."
"Of course we do, son,"
Mr. Benjamin replied as he handed Charlie a cell phone.
"We know nothing will go wrong, but just in case it does, I put our home number on speed dial so you can call quickly if something absolutely catastrophic occurs."
"Thanks, Dad,"
Charlie said resignedly, taking the phone from him.
"And if you look in your backpack," his mother added, "you'll find earplugs in a little baggie. You can use them if the other children tease you and call you horrible names." "Okay, Mom," Charlie said, wishing desperately that they would leave. They just stood there.
"Well," Mr. Benjamin said finally, "I guess we had better go. We love you, son, and we trust you, and we feel certain in our hearts and in our souls that nothing cataclysmic or disastrous will happen this evening."
"It won't," Charlie said. "Everything will be fine, I promise."
And everything was fine, for a while. Charlie played computer games, ate pizza, and watched PG-13 horror movies. Incredibly, he even found himself on the verge of making a friend, a tall, blonde kid everyone called FT, which, Charlie learned, was short for FTW, which was short for the win, because of his terrific video game prowess. It was the most fun Charlie had ever had in his entire life. Then it came time to go to sleep. Accounts differed as to what exactly happened during what newspaper headlines would soon call Terror at the Sleepover Apocalypse, but certain facts were not in dispute. At some point, around 3 a.m, tremendous screaming and crashing came from the bedroom where the kids were sleeping. When the adults in the house finally managed to fling open the door, they found all of the children suspended from the ceiling, wrapped tightly in cocoons of extraordinarily tough webbing. The only child not encased and suspended from the ceiling was Charlie, who stared at the shattered bedroom window in shock.
"My God, what happened?"
gasped the father when he saw his children dangling like Christmas tree ornaments.
"A giant spider," Charlie said, and pointed to the broken window. "It left through there. It's not my fault."
No one blamed Charlie, exactly. After all, How could a 13-year-old kid have done such an extraordinary thing to so many other children? And yet, even the local newspaper reporter wondered why Charlie was the only one left unharmed by the giant spider, a fact that Charlie himself had puzzled over. Even though no one actually accused him of anything, after the kids were cut down and revived, none of them would speak to him or even look at him, not even F.T. Charlie had gone to sleep that night thinking he'd finally made a friend, but he'd woken up to find himself the object of fear and panic. It wasn't the first time. In fact, from almost the moment he was born, sleep and Charlie Benjamin were an explosive combination. The very first public disaster had happened during nap time at Welcoming Arms Preschool. Charlie was 3 years old. Even though he couldn't quite recall the specifics of the nightmare he'd had while he and the rest of the children slept on mats inside the darkened classroom, he could vividly remember the inhuman howling and shrieking that had snapped him out of it. As the preschool teachers raced in to see what could possibly be making such astonishing noise, little Charlie woke to find the classroom around him utterly destroyed. The colorful nursery rhyme wallpaper hung from the wall in ribbons, as if slashed by talons. The fish tank lay shattered against an overturned bookshelf as the fish inside frantically flipped and gasped for air. A spray of glass from the back window glittered brilliantly across an easel, which lay splintered on the floor.
"What happened?" the teacher asked, her face ashen.
"I'm sorry," little Charlie replied, shaking. "I didn't mean to do it."
"You did all this?" the teacher asked incredulously.
Charlie nodded.
"Sometimes bad things happen when I have nightmares."
The pattern was always the same. He would go to sleep at home in his soft, warm bed, and everything would seem to be fine, at least for a while. But sometime during the night, terrible snorts and growls would rip through the house. By the time his parents burst into his bedroom to see what was wrong, the place would be ruined. Mattress stuffing tossed everywhere, carpet torn, glass shattered. And even though they never actually caught him in the process of destroying a room while in the grip of a bad dream, they figured he must be doing it. It was the only explanation that made any sense. In fact, Charlie dreaded going to sleep because he was terrified about what he might find when he woke up. The incident at nap time, later dubbed the nap time catastrophe, quickly became legend, and it wasn't long before the other kids started chanting "Nightmare Charlie" at him whenever he walked by. Soon his parents were summoned before the preschool administrator, who carefully explained that Welcoming Arms would no longer be welcoming Charlie.
"The other children are afraid of him, you see," the administrator said with terrible seriousness. "In fact, they refuse to take their naps when he's in the room. This is absolutely unacceptable. Nap time is the cornerstone of the preschool experience. It is the glue that holds the remainder of the curriculum together. Without nap time, chaos is inevitable, and ruin is sure to follow."
"I can sense your passion," Charlie's father agreed in his calmest voice. "But if you think that Charlie is the cause of their distress..."
"He's not," Charlie's mother snapped as she gently rubbed her son's back with her warm, strong hands. "The other children have been teasing and tormenting him, not the other way around. My heavens, do you know what they call him? Nightmare Charlie."
"Quite right," Barrington continued. "But my point is that perhaps Charlie could be moved to a different area of the classroom while the rest of the children are sleeping."
The administrator was horrified.
"We cannot go down that slippery slope. If I make one exception for one boy, pretty soon I'll be making two exceptions for two boys.
And before you know it, it's all exceptions and no exceptions, if you get my drift.
He shook his head sadly.
No, Welcoming Arms and Nightmare Charlie, Charlie, must now go their separate ways.
Even though Welcoming Arms was the very first preschool to kick Charlie out, it certainly wasn't the last. Balance Point, Happy Child, Lil Learners, and Perfect Play Pals followed soon after. But that's where Charlie's horrible streak of getting kicked out of...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.